Hello, welcome to Nursing with Professor B. My name is Bridget. I have a master's degree in nursing education. I am also a family nurse practitioner. In today's video, I will be discussing the lab D-dimer. What is it done for? What are the implications? What does it mean if it's high? Before we get started, make sure that you hit the like button, make sure that you subscribe, and make sure you turn on that notification bell. If you do this, it helps other students find my channel that maybe they are struggling with nursing, so it helps them. So help them, and it means the world to me. Thank you so much, and let's get started. All right, today we'll be discussing D-dimer. If someone is low risk that they may have a D-dimer, but you want to rule it out, if you do the D-dimer and it's normal within normal limits, then you can usually say safely, this person does not have a blood clot. Some of the conditions that the D-dimer test is used to help rule out include a deep vein thrombosis, a DVT, pulmonary embolism, so a clot in the lung, stroke, so clot up here in the brain, and a D-dimer may also be used to help diagnose disseminated intravascular coagulation. With disseminated intravascular coagulation, it's a very sad condition. Due to some kind of trauma or other process, these individuals will start forming tiny clots in the body. And then because they use all of their body's clotting factors, when they use up all of your clotting factors, they end up bleeding very easily. So they will have bruises on their extremities, they may bleed from the nose, they may bleed from the gums by brushing their teeth, they may bleed from the IV tubing site, inserting a needle will cause a tremendous amount of bleeding, they may bleed internally, so it's a very dangerous condition. D-dimer is also known as fragment D-dimer or fibrin degradation fragment. What is fibrin? Fibrin starts out as fibrinogen in our blood, and you can see the fibrin here in the red blood cells, okay? And fibrinogen is a plasma-soluble protein, and a thrombosis is the result of an overproduction of fibrin. So when too much fibrin is formed, it creates a clot, and then that clot, for example, a frequent area of a DVT will be in the calf. So this clot area forms behind the calf. Not only is it detrimental to health, but it can be life-threatening. So examples of a clot include a deep vein thrombosis and a pulmonary embolus. So a normal finding for D-dimer depends on the units that are being measured. Normal findings for the D-dimer will be less than or equal to 500 nanograms per milliliter of fibrinogen equivalent units, FE, or less than 250 nanograms per milliliter of the D-dimer units, the DDU. An elevated D-dimer alone is insufficient to make a diagnosis of pulmonary embolus. The reason for this, and I want to make a video on sensitivity and specificity, but the D-dimer can give a lot of false positives. So a D-dimer is sensitive, but has a low specificity. What that means is if you have a blood clot, your D-dimer will usually be elevated, but if it has a lot of false negatives, so has a low specificity. It can be used to rule out a pulmonary embolus in patients with a low or intermediate probability of PE. Causes of false positives of a D-dimer. D-dimers can a lot of times be elevated in conditions that mimic inflammation, and rheumatoid arthritis is an autoimmune condition. So you may see it in RA, recent surgery, any kind of trauma, infection, a recent heart attack, cancer, sickle cell anemia, pregnancy, and even liver disease. So if in the hospital setting, you ever think that perhaps your patient may have a DVT, let's say they're complaining of leg pain, and you assess the leg, and signs of a DVT is it warm to touch? Is it red? Is it erythematous, right? So you assess the leg, it doesn't feel warm, it doesn't feel hot, they can't really pinpoint a specific area but you're kind of worried anyway, you could either order a D-dimer and a Doppler. Sometimes they'll go right to the Doppler ultrasound. Or let's say that for whatever reason, a Doppler ultrasound is not feasible at the time. You could always call the provider, say, hey, this patient is having unilateral leg pain, right? If it's both legs, it's unlikely that they have a DVT in both legs. So if it's unilateral leg pain, you don't really see any signs of a DVT, but you just want to be on the safe side. You call them, hey, can we get a D-dimer? Or another case would be if a patient says all of a sudden that they feel like they're having a little bit of shortness of breath and you're worried, like, do they have a PE? Again, you can call the provider and ask for a D-dimer to just rule that out. So I hope that this video was helpful. If you have any recommendations for any future videos, feel free to drop a comment below. I love to get feedback from you. I appreciate feedback from you. So as always, thank you so much for watching, and make sure you hit the like button, make sure that you subscribe, and make sure you turn on that notification bell. Welcome to Nursing with Professor B. My name is Bridget. I have a master's degree in nursing education.